There are many strategies. You have to begin with public policies that designate the funds to go to children at greatest risk. And so that might be federal, they might be state, they might be city or regional policies, but the funds need to be targeted. And then I think it's extremely important that you have the data to tell you where the most vulnerable children are and whether the services are getting to those regions. And it's a continuous service struggle, I would say, but it's also doable. I gave the example too in my own community in Lincoln, Nebraska, where they took a vote on the issues that were most important, and early childhood was one of three. So that kind of brought to the fore the need to think about how are all the children doing? And it, people left the idea of just doing this program here or that program there and began to think about, do we have coverage? Is everybody here? So it's that combination, I think, of the policies, the data, and the coverage. What criteria should we be using for targeting? In the United States, the easiest one to use is income level. Head Start programs target children who are at 100% of poverty in the US. Our free and reduced lunch programs target children at 185% of poverty in the US. But we know there are other risks, factors that families have as well. So some states have identified low birth weight, non-English speaking, as children of teen parents as additional risk factors. But another way to look at it is that we know that many, many factors are coexisting with poverty. And so oftentimes it's not the poverty itself, but it's all the stresses that come with being in poverty, but those affect the children as well. So you have to pretty much go full on in attack of all of those things. But when it comes to the criteria, poverty is a pretty good place to begin, at least in the US. Oh, intersectorial services, intersectional services are so important. Why is it so difficult to achieve intersectorial services? I think it's because A, they're expensive. You need somebody who has expertise in working with families on your staff, as well as the programs themselves are expensive. So that's one factor. Sometimes the monies for the programs are coming from different agencies in the government. So they have different rules and requirements and so forth. So that is a challenge. I have lots of examples of interventions that can have a positive impact on early life. Certainly in the United States, we have our premier programs. They are demonstration programs that came out of work that began in the 1970s. And so the Perry Preschool Project is a very famous one, and the children not only did well in the program, outstripping the control group, randomized control trials. You have to take that into account too. But then they followed these children into their 40s, and the return to society was at the last follow-up time 17 to 1. So that's one example. The Abecedarian program had a similar trajectory, but started with infants and toddlers. So it was more expensive to begin with, but still the payback was huge and the children were doing so much better, in the sense too that they're reversing the intergenerational aspect of poverty.